Yep.
God is good, right?
Amen.
All the time, God is good. We, Mike and I had a good little getaway. You'll have to tell you the stories sometime.
All I got to say is it was an old 1861 Civil War house. It was an underground railroad and it was haunted.
We had doors kept opening
and closing. Temperatures dropped 20 degrees.
Lights going
on and off.
Any scary dogs?
Just mine. He kept running from room to room looking up like this.
And there were no neighbors around set up, and you couldn't, out at night, you couldn't see your hand in front of you. It was spooky.
He was scared. He stayed up till like 2 and 3 in the morning with every light in the house. I'm like, you got God inside of you, honey. Rebuke that thing.
I read an article about the owner did the research and said that they had that like stowaway, that secret room there with an apartment.
Big old chicken. I'm not afraid of that.
I stayed up at night while she was
sleeping. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Long Alan.
He kept saying, would you stay there again? I'm like, well, yeah, I'm not afraid of that stuff. Hey, you can get behind me, you know?
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm going to say one more thing about it. When we left, the morning we left, there was a welcome sign laying at the base of a tree, and I was the first one out that morning. It was turned upside down. I said, don't come back.
Chicken.
Right.
He is. He's chicken, bigger chicken. Anybody can scare him to death, I bet.
I can't see it. I can't fight it.
Oh, but God is good all the time, isn't he? Hallelujah, hallelujah. We just give our lives to him. He'll work it out. Sometimes we try to go too fast, but go slow. You know, let the Lord lead you.
I was going to say, I'm thinking about that. Reminded me of my grandson was with me one night, and some made a noise. I asked him, I said, you scared? He looked at me and said, Jesus is bigger than the boogie.
Amen. And that's what I kept trying to tell Mike. You know, hey, you got Christ inside of you, the Holy Ghost. You don't have to be afraid of that stuff.
Well, I thought it was kind of strange as I went in, and next to the door they had hand carved a rifle that looked like a real rifle, and I thought, well, that was the reason.
Yeah.
Still
scared.
It is.
Sounds cute.
Well, we've got some work going on out there for announcements. As you can see, we've got the foundation being put in. It'll be done this week. And
well, I thought we just had a bad case of mold.
And then we'll be having the house brought in, hopefully the end of September. Set on there. Hallelujah. Then you all men can start working on the inside. But, you know, it's amazing what God is doing in this small little church, I'll tell you. It just goes to show you, you know, if you ever look at that little picture of God as you're going into my office, it's got hands put together. It, never underestimate what God can do with a small group. He only took 12, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it reached out all over the world. So God is working in this church.
Amen.
And he's going to bring in more people. I know he is. So let's open in prayer. We got some other things going on. I have asked Bob to be the activity director for the youth. And he has graciously accepted that offer. So
he's taking where you guys went. That'll keep him quiet.
But anyway, he has accepted that offer, and whatever he chooses to do with the youth, that's fine with me. You know, I know he'll do good things with the youth, and we've got a pretty good sum of money saved up for the youth, so he can just whenever, you know, he can just do whenever. But I think it's like
$509.
Yeah. So we got quite a bit for these, so we can do things with them. And also, through this past week, Mary Trammell had a heart attack, and she was in cardiac arrest, and they tried to resuscitate her for like 3 hours, I think. And She finally got a heartbeat back, and she is in the hospital of Marion right now, and they don't know if she's going to recover or not, basically. They took her body temperature down to 90 degrees, and then they started warming her up last night around 5. And they will know today when they do a brain scan to see if she has any brain activity or not. But just keep Mike in prayer. Mike's a mess. You know, when you lose the person that you love the most, you know, it's devastating. It changes your whole world. So let's just keep him and Mary in prayer. You know, I still believe God can walk right in there and just zap her and she could just recover. You know, God has power. Amen. He has power. And sometimes we think that, you know, just because the doctors say this, that it's lost. But no. No, it isn't. Because they're not God.
You remember that movie, Do You Believe? That's a good example
of that. Right. Do You Believe? You've ever seen that movie. It's really good. And War Room's really good, too. Hey. Wow. But I wanted to say that I had asked Carol. She has a minister's license. And I had asked her, since I was gone, if she would step in, if things like this would come up, and go to the hospital, or, you know, do what needs to be done if I'm gone, or if I'm, you know, unavailable. Her and Kristen maybe can get together, Helen and Diane and whoever, and go up. But since Carol holds a minister's license already, then I've asked her to be like a substitute that would go up there, because Bruce, he works during the day a lot, and if it's not on, you know, if it's during the week, then it's hard to get someone from the church to go up. If it's on the weekend, Bruce is available, but if it's through the week, then we need someone. So, you know, I knew that she had told me she had a minister's license, so she said she found it, and she graciously accepted that, so. I'm just glad that we've got people that will step in, and you know, and Diane's an elder. She'd be one that could go too. I mean, we've got substitutes. So, there you go. Who's an elder?
Yep.
It went over my head.
That might be best, Mike. That might be best.
It went over my head.
You said an elder. I said a really elder.
Well, we'll be talking a little bit about that today, too. And the book of Titus. We're starting on the book of Titus today. So that will give us a little bit of a go ahead. We may be late today. We're getting late start. But anyway, let's open in prayer. Father, we just thank you so very much for this little church. Yes. We thank you for the people you've put in this little church, Lord. Lord, they're loving, and they're caring, and they're giving, and they look out for one another, and they pray for one another, Lord, and we hold each other up. And I just want to thank you, because that's rare. Even in the big churches, that's rare, Lord. Never underestimate what a small group of people can do, right? You took 12.
Yes, Jesus.
You took 12 people and showed us how you can change the world. We thank you so very much, Lord. And as we go into your word, Father, I just ask that every ear would be open to hear and receive, and every heart would be softened. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
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 Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Oh,
Will be joy, your people cry. for our sins, Lord, excuse me. Hallelujah. We thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
You stood before creation. Eternity.
Yes, hallelujah. Pray.
And you spoke the earth into motion. My soul rises. You stood before my failure. Carried the cross. My sin weighed upon your shoulders, my soul now to sing.
Praise your wonderful name, Lord. You may be seated. Hallelujah. God is so good. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. 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 Praise your name. I always want to give opportunity for the Lord to move. God's doing anybody about anything. Hallelujah. I'm speaking. Now, I kept seeing the butterfly. Somebody's wings is breaking out. Amen. Somebody's wings are breaking out. I don't know. Hallelujah. What's a butterfly mean? When, you know, it comes out of the shell, you know how you, that cocoon, you know, the worm's in that cocoon and it's struggling and it's been in there, what, 9 months, something like that, 18 months, I don't know how long, but struggles to get out, you know, it's breaking that shell. And it's trying to get out of that hard cocoon, and it has to struggle and struggle. And sometimes our life is like that, trying to get out of that hard place we're in, you know. And we're just trying to break free from bondage, or we're trying to break free from our lifestyle. We're trying to break free from people, what they say about us, or anything. It could be shackles, you know, that are just chained to us. It's like a butterfly breaking out. And I didn't see it just sitting. It was going like this. Yeah. So that means it's moving. It's in action. Amen. Hallelujah. God is good. Woo! God is something. Glory. Glory.
Amen.
Spirit guns.
That's right.
Spirit guns, we call them. Spirit guns. Right.
Thank you.
A Holy Ghost goose punch or something like that. You get those, that's when you know God. Hey girl, I'm speaking to you, or hey guy, I'm speaking to you, or he's confirming something. We're going to be in Titus. And to give you a little bit of introduction, it's this greeting is more than an opening part of the letter. It's a statement, more or less. The place where the word is in the life of the local church. And what it's really, Titus is a book that's really a call to purity. It's a call to our actions. It's a call to how we go about our everyday lives. You know, I mean, we can't just come to church on Sunday and be holy and spiritual and act good and nice and not get angry and be polite and then go back out in the world and cuss and we get angry all the time and tell somebody off and maybe beat somebody up, or somebody passes in front of you in the car and you flip them off. I mean, we just can't. People watch us, right?
Yes.
We have to, our actions have to say, I'm a Christian. Our actions have to say, I belong to God. Our actions have to say, hey, I'm a woman of God. I'm a man of God. I'm living for Him.
Yes.
So this book's a call to purity. One of the problems in Crete was an abuse of the grace of God. Grace is wonderful, isn't it? I mean, God saved us and gave us grace, and then He had mercy on us. He saved us by grace. And these people in Crete, they argued and they took grace and they expounded on it. They sinned. Well, I'm saved by grace. I do whatever I want to do, right? You know, I'm free. I'm free. I do whatever I want to do. Well, Paul's answer to this teaching is faith is the truth, which is after godliness. That's what Paul is teaching Titus. Faith is truth. Truth which is after godliness. Are we after godliness today? Do we want to live our life like godliness? Do we want to set an example for others? Do we want to be a witness? Does what we wear
give us a witness today. Now, don't, you know, we went away and Mike thought I needed some bling, so don't. I'm not a bling gal, but, you know, I kind of like this. But is what we wear, I mean, like low-cut shirts or high-up skirts or, you know, with guys, really, really tight pants, you know, or, you know, they lit the button down here with the gold chains, you know. Is what we wear, is that some example for us to be a Christian? Or what others look at us, or how we, our actions, is our handshake a handshake, or is it like, give five, buddy? Or, you know, how we act, what we say, how we say it, it all sets an example for people. And godliness, actually, it means practical holiness in one's daily life. Are we practicing being holy? Now that sounds, you know, I'm not holy. I'm not holy. How can I be holy? How can I be spiritual? Well, right here, you got spirit inside you. Spirit tells you things. Spirit says, no, better not go there. Spirit will put up a red flag in front of you and say, like one of those, ever see that commercial on TV where the guy goes in and he's working on the, what is that old game where you have operation, yeah, you go in there and you're and it goes, well, sometimes I think Spirit gives us those signs in our life. Slow down, you're moving too fast. We need to pay attention to those signs. Because it's Spirit talking to us. The Holy Spirit, you know. And Paul explains that grace saves us and also disciplines us to be dedicated, to live our lives dedicated to God. You know, back in the day, back in my day, when we were dating, you know, and a guy would take a woman out and you'd date, you know, a guy might try to, you know, move in and give him a kiss at night or something like that. But, you know, back in my day, I really thought a woman, as a woman, that a guy should ask permission, that he shouldn't just move in on it. And I always thought that was nice of my husband because he said, can I kiss you? May I kiss you? Or something. I don't remember what it was, how he exactly said it when we were first dating. He didn't just give me a kiss, you know. And I think sometimes when you're dedicated to trying to live a godly life, you need to set those boundaries. You need to have the, you know, I better not go to that party because there could be something that may happen. It wouldn't look good. Somebody might look at me and judge me, you know, if I go in there. Or, you know, even going to the movies sometimes can be if, how it's rated. For me, as a pastor, Mike, you know, told me that. Because, you know, you shouldn't go to something that's PG-13 because there may be cussing in it and stuff. And even though it may not have bad parts, it does have the foul language. So we have to weigh things, you know, and sometimes PG-13 movies aren't bad at all. It's for whatever reason. But we have to weigh things. Our life has to speak, I'm living godly. I'm trying to live godly. I'm trying to live holy. That makes sense? Because people watch us. People watch us. And how can we catch them if we don't use the right bait? There's also people out there in the world that are evil. The person who uses the doctrine of grace to excuse sins either is not saved or does not understand what grace really is. Now, grace isn't a license to sin. Grace,
amen.
Grace is a license to become holy, to become closer to God, to become who God wants you to be. That's what grace is. A part of it, anyway. Titus assisted Paul, who was in Crete, and Paul later left And he left Titus in charge. And he left Titus with a very hard thing to do because Crete was full of people who were unholy. They were lazy. They were gluttons. They were gossipers. They didn't want to work. They did whatever they wanted to do. They partied all the time. You know, Crete was full of people that just thought, you know, hey, come stand by grace, I'm going to do whatever I want to do. I'm going to stay out all night and party and then get up and the next morning go to church. You know, people do that all the time. They do that all the time. I used to do it. And he was given a hard task. He had to go out to each city. Paul tells him to go out to each city and grab men and make elders out of them and teach them and train them. Well, I imagine in Crete it was hard to find men who wanted to live holy lives, who really wanted to be dedicated. You know, they got this thing on TV called Christian Singles or Mingles or whatever.com, and you can get on there and try to find a mate. Hey, let me tell you something. Evil people, when I say evil people, I mean people who are dedicated to Satan, not God. There's evil ones out there in the world too. And they'll get on there and say, I'm a Christian. Let me tell you, just because somebody says they're a Christian does not mean they're a Christian. Mm-hmm. So you have to be aware of that. I'm going to read Titus 1 through 3, and then we'll decipher that. Paul, a bondservant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of those chosen of God and the knowledge of truth, which is according to godliness, in the hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised long ago, ages ago, but at the proper time manifested even his word in the proclamation with which I was entrusted according to the commandment of God our Savior. I wonder if we could put our name in here in these first verses. I'm going to use Kathy. Because she's smiling at me. Amen. Yes. Kathy, a bondservant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of those chosen of God and the knowledge of truth, which is according to godliness. Bob, a bondservant of God and an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of those chosen of God and the knowledge of the truth, which is according to godliness. Amen. Carol, Helen, Mike, Chrissy, Bruce, Sherry, and on and on, and Barb, and on and on, Diane, and Judy, and Steve, and, you know, on and on. I wonder if we could put our name in front. For we, if we are Christians, could all say, we have knowledge of the truth, which brings godliness, right? We have knowledge of the truth which brings godliness. Jesus is truth. Jesus Christ is truth. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is the one who changes our hearts, our lives, mm-hmm. everything. Everything. Mm-hmm. God, who cannot lie, has promised us that. We know that when we were saved, born again, at that time, we know. We had that Damascus experience. I was talking about that with Helen yesterday. When we get saved and Christ comes in our heart, we know that we know that we know there is a God. Because mm-hmm. you've had that experience. You've had that overwhelming feeling. You've had that overwhelming anointing. You know that you know that you know that something happened and it was not you. It was supernatural. Amen. Yeah. Amen. So you had a Damascus experience. Now, it may not have been one much like Paul had, but still it was a God experience. And Paul had that. He had that experience on the road to Damascus, and it changed his whole life. He's like, hey, I'm no longer going to live the life I had before. I'm going to live for Jesus, and I'm going to give my all, and I'm going to preach the Word of God, and no matter what happens to me, I'm going to keep going. He was beaten. He was thrown out. He was stoned. He was kicked, and he kept going. Amen? He did not give up. He did not give up no matter what. All through all the pain. Through all the pain he suffered, he didn't give up.
That's right.
Amen? And he was one of the 12 apostles. Why didn't God heal him? Why did God allow all that to happen? And we think we won't go through things. We're going to go through things. But you keep your hand on the plow and you keep moving forward. You may be going through something right now. You may have been going through it for a long time, and it just doesn't seem like God is around. Doesn't seem like he's there anymore. You're just going through the motions, doing what you do every day. Well, friend, that is the time that you need to take a look back. Take a look back to when God first came into your life. And start crying out to him. I want that back, God. I want that back, God. I know you love me. I know you're here with me, Lord. I know you never leave me, Lord. But I want back that first experience I had with you, Lord. I want back that first love. First love. Go back to your first love. Amen. I remember when I was excited. Couldn't wait to get up in the morning. Grass was greener. The birds sang prettier. Everything had a different color. I was like, wow, I don't know what this is, but I'm excited. Yay, I feel alive again. I feel new again. Amen. It's like when you get a first love, too. You know how it is when you get a first love? You're just so all giddy and everything. Amen. That's what we need. We need to cry out to God. Help me, Lord. Cry out to God for your church, this church. Help the church, Lord. Pull in people, Lord. Help the church grow, Lord. Help us be part of this community and do something big for this community. You think that ground out there and that house out there isn't God? It's God. It's God. Look at all the things Paul went through. Our hope is in Christ. He promised us a blessed hope, right?
Yeah.
Blessed hope. A blessed hope. Blessed hope of eternal life. We have that promise with him. We have that. By faith, we know that we're going to have that. And some people will say, oh, how do you know for sure? How do you know there's another life? How do you know you're going to go to heaven? How do you know that for sure? You know it by faith, but also if you've been around people that's had an out-of-body experience, they can tell you. I can tell you. There's life out there. There's life with Christ. I don't understand the whole concept of how the Spirit's going to connect and how we're all going to go up. Or when God comes down, we're going to be with him if he's in the air or he's on the ground. Like I've heard people say, I don't know for sure, but in the end, it's all going to pan out. I'm going to be here, I believe, but others think we're going to go up and say, hey, that's okay. It's all going to pan out in the end. But our hope is in him because we know he's coming back. Amen. Do you know that he's with you today? Do you know that God is in your heart today? If you don't know for sure, then ask him in your heart. If you don't know for sure, then ask him right there in your chair. He'll come in your heart. He'll wash you clean. You may make mistakes. We all make mistakes. But hey, you keep going. You get up and keep going, right? He carries you. He strengthens you.
Philippians 4:3, he strengthens you. He's your strength to keep going. 4-9. To Titus, my true child, in a common faith, grace and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus, our Savior. For this reason I left you in Crete, that you would set in order what remains and appoint elders in every city as I directed you. Namely, if any man is above reproach, the husband of one wife, having children who believe, not accused of dissension or rebellion, for the overseer must be above reproach as God's steward. Not self-willed, not quick-tempered, not addicted to wine, not pungentous, not fond of sordid gain, but hospitality, loving what is good, sensible, just, devout, self-controlled, holding fast the faithful word which is in accordance with the teaching, so that he will be able both to exhort in sound doctrine and to refute those who contradict. And this is what was happening. They had false teachers going in Crete, and they were telling them all kinds of things and telling them they had to do this and do that, and they didn't have to do it. And they also were going in Crete wanting to be paid. Teachers wanting to be paid. So Paul, you know, Paul thinks a lot of Titus, because Paul brought Titus up and trained him. And he calls him, when he says, one of true faith. One he can count on when he needs to take care of something. Somebody you know is of the true faith. You know you can count on if you need something done. Call them on the phone and you say, hey, you know, I can't be there, you know, and I got to trust you to take care of this. Can you do this? Yeah. And you can hang up the phone and you can know sure in your heart it's going to be taken care of. That's how Paul felt with Titus. He has to trust. He has to trust. Maybe he has to even know that Titus is available to do it. Because you know when you need something done right away, the person has to be available. Titus was there. He was there to carry out and not called for employment. It wasn't something that, hey, okay, you want me to do this job, then you're going to pay me this much for it. No, he did it because he knew that the other was calling on him in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. He tells us that an overseer or a bishop, as the King James Version puts it, King James Version says bishop, must be above reproach. Now, the noun is said hiscopus. It's found six times, which the consistent meaning bishop or overseer. The term exclusively denotes one who is given the spiritual charge of a local congregation or group of congregations. Refers to Christ as the supreme overseer of our souls. So an overseer is more than what, in some terms, it would say that it is a superintendent, but not like we would see a superintendent. Today, in our culture, a superintendent is kind of someone who takes care of the building. But this means, as an overseer, it means it's somebody who's like an elder who could take control in spiritual matters of the church. And that happens. Now, when we're talking about he must be a man of one wife. Now, I've heard of other churches putting a halt to a Christian believer wanting to have the position of an elder or a deacon. And I've heard that they say, no, son, you're sorry, you've been married before and divorced, so you can't serve in the church. How sad is that? How sad is that? They're missing a great opportunity. Because I'll tell you, there's few men out there that really want to live godly lives. And when you have somebody that wants to serve like that, and they're told, no, they can't.
It's a shame. For that reason, I don't like those doctrinal churches. But I'll tell you something. God forgives divorce. Amen. God forgives divorce. Mm-hmm. And God sets guidelines in the Bible for divorce. And if you follow through those guidelines, hey, you are free to serve. For some who truly have a heart, it breaks their heart when they're told they can't do something. Because it's like saying, well, you're not a holy person, you're defected. There's something wrong with you. You're defected, so we can't use you. It's like in the old days, you know, when the kids would go, you got cooties. Stay away from me. That is so sad in our church life. How we do that to people who have a heart for God and want to serve God, and we tell them no because they've been divorced before? Well, let me see here. David, who was a man after God's own heart, the Bible says. David, I think he committed adultery. Oh gosh, and he wanted that woman so bad that he even murdered her husband. David, right? And he was still anointed. He was still used of God. Because he cried out for God in repentance, right? He asked for God to forgive him, right? And God forgave him, and God still used him. There were consequences for his sin, but God still used him. So what right do we have today to tell somebody no, because we don't know for sure if they've repented? God is the judge over that, honey. Amen?
Amen.
One wife means exactly what it says. One wife. You see, back in the day, back then they used to marry more than one woman. They have like four or five wives, even more than that. And if you're going to be an elder dedicated to the church, or a deacon dedicated to the church, you know, if you've got that many wives, it's kind of hard to take care of things, isn't it? It takes all your time. So he was meaning, I want you to be married to one woman because that's about all you can handle. And handle a church congregation. And it's true. One person. I want you to be married to one person. Because the first needs to be God. We need to be married to God. He needs to be number one. Before my husband, before your wife, God needs to be number one, is he?
Amen.
Have you put him place in your life? Do you give him your all?
Amen.
Give him your all. Because if you make God number one, he will let everything else fall into place.
Amen.
I guarantee it. I guarantee it. You cannot curse what God has blessed. You cannot curse what God has blessed. Amen.
Amen.
God has blessed this little church. I have a heart to see God move in this church, and he is. And it may not be in the way that maybe people expect, but he's moving.
Amen.
It's amazing what God can do. He works in mysterious ways. I've seen him just take things and turn them around. I'm like going, yeah, that okay. It's amazing. God can still do miracles today if he wants to. He can still touch Mary right up there in the hospital and do a miracle right there. He can touch Judy Wiles and do a miracle in her body. Amen?
Amen.
He can touch anybody who is ailing. He can touch Jackie and heal her body. And that's what I want to see God do. I want to see God touch people today and move. I want to see him work through me when I lay hands on somebody that they're going to be healed in the name of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. God's still alive and active today. But we have to search him out. We have to fall on our face before him. We have to go into our room and cry with a war cry out to him in prayer. And if any of you can go see War Room, go see it. It's an excellent movie. And that's what this whole nation needs, is to cry out to God. We can't get drunk and expect people to look at us like we're Christians. We can't go around acting like we can do anything. We need to be sober-minded either way, drunk or pills or heroin or cocaine or whatever it is. Even sober-minded in our thinking. Now think about this for a minute. No substance at all, right? But you can have the most negative attitude in the world, and that's not sober-minded. There has to be a balance. There always has to be a balance to things, to be sober-minded. We need to be loving people, welcoming people into our house, because it speaks of hospitality. And for a man, you know, a man, their house is their kingdom. Sometimes they don't want, you know, people coming in. I mean, but here's what it's saying. We need to be hospitable to our brothers and sisters. Now, who's our brothers and sisters? It's ones we know love the Lord. Or ones we're trying to lead to the Lord. Or people we know who are good people. But see, there's evil people. Just like there's people out there living for God. Now listen up. There's people out there living for Satan. So you have to be careful who you allow in your house. You have to be careful who you lay hands on. You have to know that the person is a good man. You know, there's good people. Let's read 10 and 11. For there are many rebellious men, empty talkers, and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision, who must be silenced because they are upsetting whole families, teaching things that they should not teach for the sake of sordid gain, rebellious men. Now I look rebellious up in Strong's, and it means subject to meaning someone who will not come under the submission of Christ. They don't want to follow orders from their pastor or the Bible. You know, if I tell Kathy I want her to lead I feel like she's called to lead a group of kids or something like that. She says, nah, I'm not even going to try it. You know, or you know, or I give somebody else a list to do something and they're like, oh no. You see, you can say no, but then you can go home and say, I just can't believe that she asked me to do that. Who she think she is? Why do you think? You see what I'm saying? Rebellious. Now, to me, because I think there's a deeper root word, a deeper root prime from that in the Greek. For me, it's pride. It's pride that says, no, I'm too good for that. You know, pride will get us in trouble. If we cannot follow authority, you know, if you cannot follow authority, you have a problem. If I cannot follow authority from my husband or God, I have a problem. I have a problem. I wouldn't be standing here if it wasn't for my husband. My husband's my head. God is my head as long as I'm behind this pulpit. But he's my head everywhere else. You see, he's my head. And if we have a problem or an argument or something like that, and I say yes, he says no, then it's going to be no. But see, I can go in my war room and I can pray. Hallelujah. And if God wants to change it, God will change his heart. Mm-hmm. Now, I don't have to say a word. But see, if God doesn't change it, then it wasn't meant to be. Then it was supposed to be His way. And I'm okay with that, right? We women have to be, because it's God's word. I'm not naive enough to believe that that I go home from preaching and some of you don't say a few words about things. I'm not naive enough to believe it because I know how I was. And that's okay. We all have different views and different opinions and stuff. You might go home and say, you know, I don't like that kind of music. I wish she wouldn't play that. Or, you know, she didn't say hi to me today, and I wonder what's wrong with her. Or she didn't smile today. Or you know, she didn't shake my hand, you know. Or, you know, things like, just human things like that. And that's okay. I understand it because I used to do it too. It's okay. It's part of being human. It's part of being real. But now if you do have a real problem, please come to me because I'm easy, I feel like, to work with. We'll work it out. All right? We'll work it out. Titus had a problem with teachers coming in and upset whole families. And the teachers wanted to be paid. They wanted to be paid for teaching God's word. Yeah. Well, here's how I feel about that, and this is how I feel about it. God says to freely give. Freely give. And I take that to mean that I don't believe that anybody should be paid for teaching God's word. I mean, the way we see it today, give you a paycheck. If the church is going to give me a paycheck, it's going to be this amount every week. I mean, my husband discussed this, you know. I don't believe in being paid like that. Because I believe that the word should be given freely. That I, as a minister, should teach the word freely. Now, here's the thing. I do also believe, like Luke 10:7 says, a man, a laborer is worthy of his call, or something like that. So that means he's worthy to receive money for his teaching. So here's how I feel about it. I feel that if you want to give to me for teaching, it's a love offering. You know, that's why I have a basket back there. It says Pastor's Love Offering. If you want to give out of the love of your heart, give freely. That's a blessing for you. But see, I don't ask to be paid. I don't ask for money because I feel like God is going to take care of it, you know? I do believe people should tithe. I do believe in tithing. I do believe that that's your blessing. That's your blessing. And when you tithe, you're helping the church. You're helping the church with the utility bills. You're helping your church with the heat. You're helping your church with any outreach programs. Just to stay open. That's your tithe. That doesn't come to me. See, a lot of people think that way. It doesn't come to me. It comes to your building. So that you can come in when you want to come in. That you can invite people in to have a, you know, birthday party. Or you can come here and pray. It's for you. And I know that's different from what a lot of other pastors feel and believe. But that's my heart, you know. That's my heart, and I hope that you accept that because, you know, if you want to give to me, that's fine, but I don't ask it. 12 through 16. One of themselves, a prophet of their own, said, Cretans are always liars, evil beasts, lazy gluttons. This testimony is true. For this reason, reprove them severely, so that they may be sound in the faith, not paying attention to Jewish myths and commandments of men who turn away from the truth. To the pure, all things are pure, but to those who are defiled, all unbelieving, nothing is pure, but both their mind and their conscience are defiled. They profess to know God. Now listen. They profess to know God, but their deeds, they deny Him. Being detestable and disobedient and worthless for any good deed. Worthless for any good deed. I love that last verse because it about says it all. They profess to know God. They're saying they're a Christian now. They're saying they're a Christian. But their deeds deny Him. Now what are deeds? Their works. Their acts. Actions. Their words. Where they go. Who they hang out with. Being detestable and disobedient. Now what's disobedient? That's just disobedient to God's word. And worthless for any good deed. That means if you're disobedient to God's word and you're saying you're a Christian, you're worthless, basically. Wow. Out in strong words. Grace is always the cause, it seems like, for the fall. Grace, you're saved by grace. God loves me. Yeah, He does, you know. God loves you with an everlasting love. And He wants to wrap His arms around you and cradle you and love you and bless you. And He never gives up on you. Even if you feel like you've lost it, you haven't lost it. You just need to come back. Let's see. We can't do whatever we want and get by with it. There's consequences. We can't go out and commit adultery and get drunk and do all kinds of things because there are consequences to that. Breaks up families. It causes the kids to turn to drugs. There's consequences for our sin. You grow up in a home that's dealing drugs and doing drugs and making drugs, and the kids are running around and they see that, they think it's okay, and they hear the cussing, they see the needle going in the arm, and what do? They grow up and do the same thing. Jesus, have mercy on us, because this whole community needs prayer. You can't walk around the corner without someone using. Now I'm telling you, it's bad in this city. And this community needs to wake up and pray. Pray for our jail ministry. Hallelujah. It's going great. Pray for our jail ministry. Men and women. Hallelujah. Pray for the prison. We go to the prison sometimes. God moves. Someone tells you that they know Christ, but then their actions tell you they don't. Then get away. Walk away. Like somebody saying they're a Christian and then they go to the store and they steal something, put it in their pocket. What the heck is that? See, our actions tell the truth. I can tell you one thing. God created everything. You, me, all people in the world. But are there those who work for Satan? Well, we need to be aware. If a believer is disobedient to God's word, what it says, and they're being detestable, as Paul says, they're not good for any good deed. In this whole chapter of the Bible, it tells us how to live our life. It's a call to purity. Say, hey, wake up. Quit messing around with worldly stuff. Wake up and live for God. Now, if we wake up and live for God, He is going to work for us. He's going to go to bat for us. He's going to bring things into your life that you want and need or have or just never thought you could ever get, and boom, right there it is. God will bring things around and things will start happening and you'll go, wow. How did I get to where I am now? Wow. How did this ever happen in my life? Wow, you know, I have prayed so hard for so long and boom, here it is. God's amazing. Amen. Me and Carol was just talking yesterday about how God's brought her here and Helen here. And then Barb and Chrissy and all working in the jail ministry and in the house ministry and the ones who got saved and are going into recovery meetings and AA meetings and NA meetings and celebrate recovery meetings. And we were just talking how just God's just bringing people around who know the ministry. That kind of ministry is what I'm saying. Because it's a hard ministry. And I was just sitting there, I'm amazed at what he's doing. I'm amazed that Mike and I went down to get the variance. We thought we was going to have a hard time to get that because, you know, you just can't have a housing project for women come in. I mean, they had a hard time over there across the street. Then we sat there and they said we didn't even need one. I'm like, huh?
Praise Lord.
Praise God that the church, because we were going to umbrella it under the church. Praise God that churches have that right. Hallelujah.
That's right.
So let's ask ourselves some questions here from this chapter. Are we lazy? Are we lazy people? Sometimes I want to be lazy, I'll be honest. Are we dishonest people? Who we sometimes give, you know, a little white lie? Do we get angry all the time and start cussing? Are we gluttons? Not just with food. Well, if it was one of Bob's long cakes.
Or six.
Or six. I took them home. But those are things, you know, that we learn out of this chapter. It gives us something to think about. How is our walk? How is our walk? Do we need to clean up our act? Do we need to get things in order? Do we need to change something? Maybe we say a word that's not really a cuss word, but it just doesn't sound too good coming out of your mouth. Do we need to work on those areas in our life? Well, if we do, let's think about that this week, okay? Let's ask God to help us. Help us with whatever He wants to mold in our life. Whatever He wants to shape in our life. You know, God can mold a beautiful life if we give it to Him. He can just shape that beautiful life if we give it to Him. If we let Him. You think about the hands of a potter. He doesn't just go like this and try to get it done. It's smooth.
Yeah.
And it's slow. And He slowly molds that thing into a beautiful vase. Think about this week. We want what we want. We want microwave lives, don't we? Get it done. Ding. Well, sometimes some of us have learned that lesson to slow down. Let's close in prayer. Thank you, Father, for this word, Lord, and for your wonderful teaching out of Titus. I was going to start in this book and I thought, what the world is in Titus? You know, what can we glean out of Titus? But this first chapter was just amazing, Father. A call to purity. A call to walk godly. A call for holiness. May we be holy as you are holy, Lord. We ask that you bless everyone here, Father God, that your face would shine upon them, Lord, that you give them blessings throughout this week, Lord. Pour out your spirit in this church and in their lives and families, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you. Thank you guys for coming, and God bless you. The word works when you work it. Amen.
That's right.
You come back again, yeah? Y'all here, and I have a...
That's right, Bob.
Love you. Love you, sir. Uh-oh.
We got work this weekend. We got people.